Ah, my head. No. Frankly, terrible start to the lecture. It is the second lecture in my series just for novices. A series of lectures which is aimed at people who know how the pieces move, but from that starting point to say around 1,000, 1,200 on Lead Chess, maybe. I am Tarnum J. I'm from the Netherlands. I sometimes stream chess. I've been playing chess for, let's say, about 25 years now. My rating with the Dutch Chess Federation is 1761. My Lead Chess ratings I will just show in chat. One moment. There we go. And yeah, I've been teaching some kids every now and then before the virus. But yeah, with this lockdown, I am now streaming this and hosting this lecture series, where I always have a student who is there to help me when I might say things that seem obvious to me and therefore go too fast. And that student is the student and sponsor, just like last week. It's Peter. Peter, please introduce yourself to the fine people.
Hey, I'm Peter. I'm standing in as a novice. My ratings are about 700 on Lead Chess, so I'm a proper novice. I'm also from Enschede, so of course I'm also Dutch. And yeah, I'm here to help Tarnum get not too fast. And moreover, I have to say that Tarnum is here to help me because I also want to get a little bit of better in chess.
Okay, cool. So, what are we going to talk about today? If you can read beneath me, it says spotting tactics in games. So maybe not everybody knows what a tactic is. Let's first explain that. A tactic, basically what you see in a puzzle. In more general terms, the difference between strategy and tactic is a strategy is like finding a bigger overall goal, whereas tactic is how to actually achieve it. So, for instance, seeing, hey, if I make this move, I'm gonna win a knight, that's a tactic. Seeing, hey, all my opponent's pieces are far away from the king. Let's see if we can do something with that king. That's a strategy. And why am I talking about spotting tactics in games? Well, a long time ago, I was a little kid, believe it or not, and I was studying some chess. And I complained to my teacher, like, we're discussing really complicated tactics, but and I spot them in our study because the study it says at the top of the page, hey, these puzzles have this theme, so that really helps. But in the game. In the games I play, I'm never ever gonna see things like this because nobody tells me at that point, hey, there's something to look out for in this game. At that point, I was on step four, as they call it. It's like grade four in that chess study, and I saw maybe at that point I started seeing those tactics we discussed in grade two. So, and my teacher said to me, I don't know, just try seeing them in games, which I don't think was the best advice. So for this particular lecture, I'm not only gonna introduce you to some pretty basic tactics, I'm also gonna say, hey, what should you be looking out for during in your games? By the way, welcome, Ace. I'm not having music during the lectures because what we're saying is kind of a bit more important and maybe helps with YouTube and stuff. Okay. Finally, why did I say it? So that's the spotting in games part. I think most people who play chess are mainly, if they do puzzles, it's probably mainly to get better in chess and not for the puzzles in and of themselves. Of course, there may be people who actually just do it for the puzzles, and that's totally fine as well. It's a lot less stressful than actually playing games. And to be honest, games, they sometimes have their boring bits. Puzzles is like chess with all the boring bits cut out, you know? So, yeah. I am gonna show some, you could call them puzzles, on stream or on the screen, but they're gonna be really easy because I took all the distractions away. Normally when you see a puzzle, a lot of things is going on and you have to figure out, hey, what is actually the thing to look for. I took all of those away, which, well, you're gonna see pretty soon. It's gonna make things a lot easier. And after I discussed one particular tactic, we are gonna actually do a couple of puzzles I haven't seen yet. So I don't keep on repeating myself or go really, really fast through the different kinds of tactics. With all of that being said, let's go to the first kind of tactics. And that is, no, wait, this is not what I wanted. Pro lecturer confirmed. The first kind of tactics is a fork. Called a fork because with one piece you attack multiple things. It's like you have multiple prongs going in different direction, and that's sort of like a fork, I suppose. So, Peter, given that you know that you are looking for one piece to attack multiple things, doesn't even have to be multiple pieces, but we'll get to that later. What do you think the move is here?
This is, to be honest, pretty logical to me. You can see that the king is on one square on the board, completely up left, and the rook is completely down right, so it has to be d5.
The way to name a move is the piece and the square.
Then bishop to d5.
Bishop to d5, indeed. By the way, hello everybody who joined the stream. Happy to have you here. I'm gonna probably be a bit less interactive with chat unless there's specific questions about what we're doing here. But feel free to chat away about everything, and I really appreciate you guys hanging out. So indeed, this is what I was kind of talking about, the bishop attacking the king and the rook. Basically, the idea is you attack two things at the same time, and really, the opponent can move only one piece at a time. That's some real grandmaster information I'm giving off here. Opponent can only move one piece at a time, so it has to leave one piece hanging. In this case, of course, because the king is one of the pieces under attack, it's going to have to move the king either here or there. Those are the two legal moves. Say here, and then white can take the rook. All right.
Well, that was pretty understandable.
Yes, I would think so. well, this might be a little bit harder. I could do some explanation, but let's first see if you get it.
Ooh. I was thinking maybe it looks like this isn't one move. I don't know if I'm right, but it looks like it isn't one move to attack two things, right?
It actually is. However, the main thing, the definition of thing maybe needs to be looked at here.
So there's one move to attack two pieces or pawns or king at once.
Two things. What can things be? They can be a king, a piece, or a square.
A square, yes.
By the way, Pen, I think Peter might be reading chat. He does have the stream open at the very least. But if you... I don't know, Peter, do you read the chat?
I have the chat open. So, yeah.
Okay. But, other people, feel kind of free to say if you know the answer.
I'll close the chat for now. Yeah, I have the chat closed.
Question is correct. Or at least, you are correct with the first move and that second move, black should defend. Should prevent, but you can then go for the other attack that you have with your first move question. So what do I mean with an attack on a square? Well, most of the time, an attack on a square means threatening checkmate on that specific square.
Yes.
Yes, you've got it, Peter?
I think I do. Because if I go queen d4, I'm attacking the rook. Let the rook away. Queen a7 checkmate.
Yes.
Ah.
So, indeed, the queen goes to d4, attacks this rook.
Meg, who let you back in the house?
Welcome, Chissy and Meg, by the way. And if Black does something, if Black sees, hey, I've got to get that rook to safety, then this is a mate threat.
Yeah.
So, because the bishop is defending the queen, so Black has to defend, has to stop that mate, for instance, b6. But then we take the rook. So this is a pin attacking a piece and a square.
Yeah.
Attacking a square is almost always, especially at this level, the attacking the square is almost always gonna be threatening mate, but it doesn't necessarily have to be. For instance, in this position, what is the answer?
I think this is winning a queen if you go knight to c6.
By the way, I will quickly check if I can make the general volumes lower. No, I can mess this and disable the intro sounds. I guess those might be very loud indeed. Goat asked a question, what I will be covering. Yes, I will cover, I will get to most of those things indeed. Sorry, back to the position. So, Peter, you were saying?
I'd say knight to c6, because you check the king, so it has to move, and then you win a queen.
Exactly, exactly. So this is the knight fork, which we're looking at. So what is the move here?
For white, right?
For white.
Yes. You can't move your queen, because that would be mate. So it has to be a knight move. Attacking.
Like remember the position we were at earlier. You knew from this position what. You saw the fork in this position?
Yes.
So, what if we have this starting position?
There's a fork here?
Yeah, well, I'm explaining this position to, or I'm using this position to explain that attacking a square does not necessarily have to be a checkmate threat.
Okay. The move you just made, attacking the rook, right?
Right. So with this move, we attack this rook. And we are threatening to win the queen this way.
Yeah.
So if black doesn't see it and says, if black sees, hey, my rook is under attack, by the way, the rook can't defend the c6 square because of the pawn here. If black sees, hey, my rook is under attack, and that's the only threat I see, then black might move the rook, and then we have this fork. Yep. So in essence, this is already a fork, because we're forking both the attack on this square and this rook.
Oh yeah.
This is already getting a bit advanced. Most of the time when I say attack a square, it's gonna mean threaten checkmate. Just one little example of where the square isn't as checkmate a mate attack.
Yeah.
So you can do all of your pieces are able to do this fork or double attack, want to call it. We've seen the queen in the previous puzzle performing the fork. It's the queen, though it can go the most squares, it may not necessarily be the best piece for double attacks. Because the queen is so valuable, you will basically never want to trade it for something else.
Mm-hmm.
Or at least, not for one piece.
No.
I've also already seen how the bishop can be used and for a fork. And in order for pieces to be forked by the bishop, or pieces or squares to be forked by the bishop, they have to be on the same diagonal. I mean, if the rook was here, I mean, you could attack it with bishop. If in fact moving here would have to double attack, but you're already attacking that rook.
Mm-hmm.
So if pieces are on the same diagonal, that's when you should maybe see if you can fork them, or if your pieces are on the same diagonal, hey, can my opponent fork my pieces?
Yeah.
Note cons. The rooks can also fork pieces. So how do where's the fork here?
The fork is rook to e5.
Rook to e5, indeed, attacking both bishops. So here, black's gonna lose either bishop.
Yeah.
So bishop needs the same diagonal to do the fork. A rook is gonna, for the same reason, need the same rank or file, the same row or column. Again, if we this isn't really a fork, because whether the rook came from this direction, it would have already been attacking this bishop, or it came from this direction, it would have already been attacking this bishop. So basically only if they are on the same rank or file would you call it a fork. And like I said at the start, I'm trying to have to see, hey, this is what I should look for in games. So also when you place things on the same rank or file, be wary of it, and be wary if your opponent if your opponent has them, if you can
take advantage of it.
All right. I mean, I said all pieces could do it, so even the king can fork. It's pretty rare, actually, because you really need the stars to align, because the king is, of course, in can be in big trouble if it becomes an active piece, and if a piece is defended, no matter which way, the king can never take it. But you know, sometimes the king can fork. For instance, here the king can play.
That's e4.
E4, indeed.
Yeah.
To attack rook and bishop. And
And if the rook tries to defend the bishop, you can just take the rook.
Yes. Either here or the here, the king can just take the rook. So the rook is more valuable than the bishop, so probably the rook's gonna go away, or maybe the king's gonna defend the rook. In those scenarios, you can get the bishop.
Yeah.
But like I said, this is gonna be pretty rare. Probably the most nasty piece when it comes to forks is the knight. I mean, sometimes people even use the term fork strictly to mean a knight fork. So like I said, With the bishops, they need the same diagonal. With the rooks, they need the same rank or file. You can kind of check for that when you make a move. Like, hey, am I placing stuff close to each other? Or am I placing stuff on the same file or same diagonal or whatever? You say, well, am I placing two of my pieces this distance apart? That is that is really, really difficult to always spot. It is for this particular reason that I sometimes say in streams that a bishop is better than a knight in general, and it is if you are like at a high level. If you are a grandmaster, then the bishop is better. But the knight is so so sneaky. You can very, very easily get into a knight fork. So, and by the way, Sir Henny, this isn't an actual game, as you might have gathered. So this is not really...
It looks like the knight came from C9, I think.
Yeah, that's probably it. So, here, of course, if we're talking about forks, we are talking about where a piece is going to be in two moves. Because, the first move is where you move it, and then the second move is where you threaten stuff.
Yeah.
So here, where you see the red circles, those are all the squares that that knight could go to in two moves.
Well, that's overwhelming.
That is kind of overwhelming. So, once more to demonstrate how tricky a knight could be.
Yeah.
Another very, very good piece for forks is the pawn, actually. That might be a surprise, the final piece that there is. And the reason that a knight is good, or that a pawn is good for a fork, is because you don't mind giving it away for a piece, trading it for a piece.
Yeah.
So an opening you might have seen me play, though in a slightly different move order, is like this, where this is considered a mistake for white. And here I take the a slight mistake, but a mistake nonetheless. Here I take the e4 pawn. Why doesn't please tell me why black? Why I haven't just blundered a knight here?
Why black hasn't blundered a knight, or why?
Yes.
Yeah. Right. Why?
I sometimes play this from black's side.
Yeah, yeah.
If this just cost a knight, I probably wouldn't play this all that often.
Yeah. So if white takes the black knight on e4, it would be a mistake.
Well, he could do it. Let's let's show it on the board. Make it maybe a bit easier. Why? Mm-hmm. I mean, white is up a knight now. What does black do?
Let's see. Yeah, on the with the pawn attacking two pieces at the same time, and your queen defends it.
Aha. Exactly. So, yeah, like I said, the pawn fork. We have it here.
And so you win the pawn in the end?
Not necessarily. I mean, the bishop could take the pawn, and then a white already has a pawn. Or bishop back, and we take the pawn takes the knight, and right. Bishop takes the pawn. Yeah. That's, I mean, it's equal material. It's more of that the opening. White opening advantage is pretty much gone here, so it's it's not particular super bad for white, but I just wanted to show why this this isn't just blundering a knight.
Yeah.
So for a pawn fork, what to look for that is pretty the pawn can only fork if pieces are on the same rank with one square in between. So like this knight and bishop.
Yeah.
Otherwise a pawn can't fork. So I mean, if I see two pieces, like I said, on the same rank with one square in between, I'm sort of triggered. Hey, can I maybe do something with the pawn fork here?
Yeah.
So I think, yeah. So, and in general, well, actually, with most of these puzzles, you should always be looking out for pieces by your opponent that are either not defended, or the pieces themselves are of high value. Because in the puzzles so far, most of the time, the opponent couldn't take back a piece. Like here, black can't defend both, so you're always gonna win. So this is looking at undefended pieces.
Mm-hmm.
For instance, also like we had in this one. Well, for this rook is defended, but the rook is higher value than the knight, so that's why we're looking at that that rook. And the queen can be defended by the king, but the queen is again higher value than the knight. So always be on the lookout for pieces that are either undefended or are high value, so that you would want so that you would be more than happy to trade them for one of your own pieces.
Yeah.
Right. With that out of the way, let's do a couple of puzzles that are about forks. So maybe not everybody knows about this, but if you in Leeches, if you go to puzzles, then to your puzzle dashboard, you can go to puzzle themes, and here, if you just go to puzzles, you're gonna get puzzles a mix of all kind of themes. But here, we can go to the motifs and to fork in our case. I'll set the difficulty level to easiest because it's based off my rating, which is. Otherwise, the puzzles would be a bit on the hard side, I suppose. So these are puzzles. They should be about the fork team. They are, however, it is Lita's players themselves who are talking about who have said it is a fork. So it may not be. But so if Peter or anybody in chat has any ideas what the solution here might be.
I have an idea.
Okay.
Queen d4 attacking the knight and the rook at the same time. And if the bishop tries to attack the queen, you can take a free bishop. So I think that's it.
Okay. Now, of course, these puzzles they are slightly more complicated. What do we do in this scenario?
Let's see if we don't take the knight, he takes our rook, but the knight is. And then we That would be a fair trade, and you pin the bishop, so I'd say let the opponent take.
Yeah, we're asking ourselves what is happening after he takes the bishop, or are you already talking?
Yeah, I was talking about opponent takes the bishop, we take the rook, and opponent takes the rook. But then the opponent has more.
Yeah, no, the opponent is up a piece. I do agree with you though, because then we win this bishop with the queen. This knight, at that point, we're equal material. Probably gonna trade off the queens. At least white has to offer to trade the queens. And probably gonna do that. And then trap the knight. The knight is trapped indeed. So we are gonna win that knight with eventually the bishop here. So let's go for it. And that is a success. As you see, it was a fork, but in real life puzzles and in real life situations, there are always going to be some complications. So I'm going to agree that this was a fork. And let's go for one more. It claims is a fork.
I don't know if you want me to open my thoughts, just talk about my thoughts.
Yeah, please do.
I was looking at queen to g7 with check, but then the knight takes, so that's not an option at all.
But that might be, but...
You take with the rook, but then the king takes, so... The king can take because the bishop is there, of course. But that isn't a fork.
Yeah, I'm thinking it may not be a fork. Actually, this puzzle that it may have been mislabeled.
That's what I thought.
What I'm seeing is, for instance, if we take with the queen, knight takes, bishop takes, one legal move, and we take, then bishop takes the rook, and the king has to move somewhere, probably here, and then the bishop takes the queen.
Yeah.
But that's not a fork, though.
That doesn't look like a fork to me, no.
I mean, I suppose it's like, oh, you're attacking the king and the rook at the same time. So, yeah, I mean, there is some forking action going on, but I think this is a bad example of a fork. Let's see if we can get one more actual fork in, perhaps.
The immediate thing I see is a knight to e7,
E2.
For king. E7. Yeah, the knight to E2, sorry, yeah. Because that attacks the king and the rook at the same time.
Yes, that's also and what I'm... That is a fork indeed. Then next up, we're going to have to ask ourselves, is it a good fork?
Most of the time, forking with checks seems like a pretty good fork to me.
Yes. Okay, so what if queen takes?
If queen takes... we maybe take the rook first with check, and then we take the queen. Sorry.
Excellent, excellent. Yes, the the instant idea somebody might have is, hey, now we win this queen, but then the rook wins our queen.
Yeah,
I'm pretty sure this is it. We take this rook first, because that's also with check. And then this rook can take our queen, but we take this queen and we've gained a rook.
Yeah.
In the whole enchilada. All right. Hey. So those are a couple of... And this was an actual fork, so... Thumbs up for it being a fork. Those were a couple of fork puzzles. Let's go back to the study. Let's go on to the next kind of tactic, unless there are any questions about forks.
For my end, not. Maybe chat has, but I don't.
Yeah, I think, by the way, Peter, feel free to open the chat. There's not a lot of spoiling going on. Yeah? And even if there was.
Okay. Yeah, sure. Hi, chat.
All right. So the next tactic we're going to look at is a pin. What is a pin? A pin is where... you attack a piece, and that piece either can't or doesn't want to move. For instance, Peter, what do you see in this situation?
I see that bishop to e4 would be an excellent move.
Yes. So this is indeed a pin, because this knight can't move. By the way, I know if purists, this is a bad puzzle, because yes, white wins this knight, but white can't win with just the king and bishop, but it's about the concept. Don't be a dick. So this is called an absolute pin, because the king was there, so it's the knight couldn't move. Flip the board. Now this knight is still pinned, but now the knight could move if it wanted, but it doesn't want to for the aforementioned reason. And this is what's called a relative pin. Just a little bit about the terminology.
Yeah, one is like you can also explain, one is a legal pin and one is an illegal pin ish.
Yeah.
Like
whether or not it's legal to move. I mean,
yeah, exactly.
The pin itself is not illegal, so.
Yeah. You're pinning me. You can't do that.
Yes. So, pins can be performed by the so-called long-distance pieces. We saw with the bishop one. Now let's go for the rook pin.
Yeah, this is also just d1.
Indeed.
With the rook, of course. Not with the...
Yes, and now once more, this knight can't move. So I don't think I have an example with the queen, but of course the queen can also pin on either diagonals or straight rows or columns. So, well, like I said earlier with the forks, like always be careful when there are pieces on the same rank or column, because like if instead like let's make a couple of moves, bam 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 bam, like in this situation we have the fork, whereas in our initial situation the fork with attacking the king, attacking the piece, whereas in this situation we had the pin. But it's still the same scenario in that there are multiple pieces on the same straight line.
Yeah.
So always be careful about those. Now, where a fork is pretty often bad, if the pieces aren't defended, because you can only move one piece in your own turn. A pin doesn't necessarily have to be bad. Like this could still be okay for black. This is probably okay for black. But by the way, I'm assuming most people will see this knight is now pinned. But that's not a big issue just yet. However, the idea behind the pin is that you basically prevented your opponent from doing things. And first you prevent them from doing things, and then you're gonna make it difficult for the opponent that they can't do anything. So here d4, everything is fine. Let's say black plays pretty much the worst move on the board. Not really the worst move. You could give away your queen, but let's say black tried to play a6 and mouse slipped to a5. What can white do here? Remember, we are talking about pins, so how can white exploit the fact that black is pinned?
Right. Yeah, the bishop of the knight can't move. It is defended, but it can't move. So maybe attack it another time, like with another piece of pawn. So like d5 with your pawn, because the d5 square isn't attacked.
Exactly. And hey. So now this knight, which was already pinned, is attacked by the pawn. So black is gonna lose this knight in this scenario. So yeah, kind of repeating myself here. A pin doesn't have to be bad, but once you are in a pin, then try attacking the pinned piece some more, because that piece can't go anywhere, or sometimes doesn't want to go anywhere. So of course pawns are very, very useful, are best suited to that task, because you don't mind trading that pawn for the knight.
Yeah.
See, I had one more thing about the pins. Ah, yes. Yes. What's the pin here?
Hmm. That's not a pin to a piece, but a pin to a square.
Excellent, excellent. So you've seen it?
I think. Is it Bishop F3?
Bishop F3, and what is pinned?
Well, the rook is pinned because if it moves, I play rook A8, and that's checkmate.
Indeed. So let's say black doesn't see it, says, oh, my rook's under attack. Let's get it to safety. Let's attack that bishop. Then this is mate. Because that bishop is now defending the rook as well as taking away the b7 escape square. So, yeah, you also spotted what I wanted. What I wanted to demonstrate with this pin, that you can also pin squares. And again, most of the time, what you would see is that those squares that are pinned are checkmate threats, but they don't necessarily have to be. They could also be other kinds of attacks, just like we saw with the double attack earlier.
Yeah.
So we see some puzzles within that theme.
Yeah, sure.
Once more, we go to the puzzle themes. This time, I think pin is also one of them. Excuse me. So, yeah, and it doesn't necessarily have to actually be a pin. It's something that was submitted by the League Chess users, but it's probably got some makings of a pin in it. Yes. Yes. Let's start. What's pinned here?
The bishop is pinned. The black bishop.
Yes. Are there other pins?
Well, to be fair, like the pawn on e6 is pinned-ish.
Yes. This is also a pin. Probably a bit less relevant because it's just a pawn, but it is still a pin, so
yeah, it's a pawn and it's defended, so I don't think for this puzzle it's really relative.
Well, I mean, yeah, you could win win that pawn because it's attacked twice and it's also with check and everything, but we start this white starts this puzzle being down a piece.
Yeah, I was thinking about Queen H7, maybe.
That's close. Well, it's not that actually makes the bishop no longer pinned.
All right.
So this is actually a good thing. I didn't talk about this during the lecture, but what I said in the pin part was, hey, we're going to take advantage of the fact that the pinned piece can't move or doesn't want to move by attacking that piece some more. It could also, you could also exploit it because that piece can't move or doesn't want to move, it can't fulfill other functions it would like to fulfill. And that is kind of a hint about this puzzle.
It wants to attack the rook, I think. It is attacking the rook, but it's pinned. But if you move rook to g7 instead of queen, you're threatening mate. H7. Yeah, you're threatening mate.
Yes, but we can defend that bishop.
But yeah,
I mean, this isn't it. Well,
all right. Wants to.
But you're close. Couldn't be closer. You said. You said rook. You said h. And so you're two-thirds of the way correct. Goat, you don't know the rating when you're you haven't solved it yet.
Rook and I think it's rook h8. And then the only legal move is to take, and then you mate with your queen to h7.
Excellent, excellent. So here, the whole putting the king to h8, putting it in the corner, means that that this king h7 move is made. So you would rather take the rook with the bishop. You can't take it with the bishop because the bishop is pinned. And that is how you exploit the pinned piece not being allowed to move.
Mm-hmm.
So as to Goat's question, this puzzle is rated 1838.
All right.
Quite indeed.
Maybe I'm thinking too fast, but what I'm seeing isn't pretty fun. Rook takes g6, and if the opponent takes, it has to be with the queen because the pawn is pinned.
Yes, excellent. So, what are the pinned pieces in this puzzle?
Right now, that's the pawn on f7.
Yes. Any more?
The pawn on g6 is also pinned.
This is indeed also pinned.
Yeah.
I agree with your assessment here. So this is once more exploiting the fact that this pawn can't move.
What would the next move be? I think let's take a queen. Or is there something better?
Are we worried about this? Right? After this, black has a pin.
Uh-huh. But let's see. Take pins.
I'd say we're not worried about that because it's gonna take him the rook to capture this this queen.
All right. So let's see. Rook takes queen, then rook to g8.
I mean, we could even take that rook at that point in time. And then beyond the piece.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
So, also, kind of, with the king here, I'm also, like, looking, do we have some kind of mate here, perhaps? But I'm not seeing it, so let's take that queen. Hey. Excellent, excellent stuff. All right. Now, the lecture is about an hour long at this point in time. I don't really want to make it much longer because, you know, concentration span and everything. So we're not done with all the kind of tactics. We'll get back to that next week. However, I do have some more general remarks, which I think I can't repeat often enough. So that's what I'm gonna say now and probably also next week. That is, if you're looking for tactics or just looking at whatever during a game, any move, look at the checks and captures you can make.
Yeah.
Because, I mean, most of the time, if there's something there, it's going to start with either a check or a capture. I mean, it's at least, you know, something where your opponent has to do something. So, and also look at after the move you are thinking about for yourself. Hey, what can my opponent check me? Can my opponent capture my pieces? And that doesn't necessarily have to mean that it's bad for you. Might be excellent, but yeah, always look at those.
Yeah. Yeah.
The second general remark is when your opponent moves a piece, well, you're probably gonna see, hey, what does that piece do at its new location? Like, if I move this this knight here, like, black should see, hey, this knight can now capture this pawn if I don't do anything. What you should also be looking at is, what does that piece no longer do because it moved? Like, this knight, when it was here, it was guarding e2. And now it's no longer guarding e2. Not that it matters in this case, but... yeah, what I'm trying to say is, don't just look at what a piece can do after it has moved, but also what it no longer does. Because, it may have undefended stuff. That's the most likely scenario. So try to keep an eye out on those things. Any questions about either those two general things I said, look at captures, look at checks, or the other one, look at what a piece is no longer doing, or about pins or forks?
No, it's perfectly clear to me right now.
Okay. Well, then we will continue... I hope for next week with the tactics to look for in games. For now, do you have a parting message to the viewers?
Well, not really, because I'll see them in chat probably.
Okie dokie. Well, then, I'm gonna hang up on you and hope to see you soon.
Yeah.
Yes. It's not quite by YouTube yet, question, but that's. It's gonna come very fast now because indeed this does conclude the lecture, so I will I will cut off the YouTube video pretty quickly after this, but the stream will go on, the stream on Twitch. I'm gonna do some, I'm gonna start off with some regular puzzles in the healthy mix, see if we get some pins and or forks in those. I mean, to kind of show some more real life examples. And then I'm also gonna play some viewers, hopefully, if they want to. So, and I'm gonna play some music, which it's not gonna be on YouTube, the music part. Any of that appeals to you, like maybe check out the Tarnum J of the twitch.tv/Tarnum J. Now though, bye YouTube, bye.